Supposing she says, doctor, yes, I am very comfortable with 4 injections a day, and you can give me whatever you like, I don't mind. But actually, in my mind, I was thinking of only 2 injections. This patient does not need an intensive therapy. Then we say, madam, we appreciate your commitment to your diabetes care, but because you are so committed, I am very sure that you will do a good job of lifestyle modification. So let's try 2 injections, and I'm very sure you will be able to manage. Even then, the patient goes back home feeling very proud. And you remember, we said thank you to her. So when I joined practice, I studied at one of the most, at perhaps the most prestigious college in India. And I went back home to a peripheral state. Equivalent in Myanmar would be me studying in Yangon and then going back to Kachin state to practice. So I went back home and I thought there will be this red carpet waiting for me, you know. The local boy has come back home and he wants to practice, he wants to set up diabetes care, endocrine care in the state. But there was no red carpet. There was no carpet at all. And I began to feel frustrated. Why is it that I am trying my best for my community? I'm actually trying my best. And the mental energy it is taking me to translate what I learned in Yangon into what is practically feasible in a peripheral setting, that mental energy nobody is able to understand. So nobody was saying thank you to me. Then again I learned from Buddhism and I began saying thank you to my patients. So to every patient there is something that you can thank him or her about. So we say thank you for taking metformin. You know how difficult it is to take 1 gram metformin tablet, but still you are taking quietly. Thank you for taking insulin. Thank you for trying to make changes in your diet and exercise. If you can't find something to thank the patient about, you thank the person who has come with her or him. So a common sentence that I would use is, thank you for taking care of my sister. I will say that to my patient's husband. Or thank you for taking care of my sister-in-law. You are a very good husband. You are a very good brother. Once I began saying thank you to my community actually began saying thank you to me. So my frustration level went down and I became a better doctor. So this is something that we have to remember in insulin therapy. We all criticize the fact that our patients, those in developing countries, are not educated enough. They do not follow our advice. We feel that American and British doctors and maybe Japanese doctors have much easier life than us when it comes to initiating insulin therapy. But that does not mean we should not initiate insulin at all. We should bring out all these things from our social strength, from our cultural strength, and utilize these. The number-based taxonomy, again, like I said, it has a very strong scientific backup. In general, if we were to use premixed insulin, we find that you can use it as once daily, you can use it as twice daily, you can also use it as thrice daily. Why is premixed important? In premixed, you have 2 types of insulin together. One is basal and one is prandial. So I am reminded of this very famous Myanmar story, which talks about a couple, and that's Ken Nari and Ken Nara. Both of them were separated for only 1 night, and that was enough to make them cry for 700 years. Any endocrinologist who is going to separate basal control and prandial control, his patients will cry for 700 years. You have to have both, whether you have it with insulin or with oral drugs. And sooner or later, we will need insulin. So either we prescribe basal bolus to all our patients, or because Ken Nari and Ken Nara are going together, we might as well prescribe in the same preparation with the same injection. And then you can prescribe once daily, twice daily, thrice daily. That negotiation skills, as we go back to our clinics, our negotiation skills will improve. So this is a very simple and very easy manner in which we can achieve comprehensive control. What is the kind of control that we want to achieve? So earlier in diabetes care, we used to think only of efficacy. So we just wanted to control fasting and postprandial. Then we learned that HbA1c is also important. So we tried to control HbA1c, fasting and postprandial. This is called the glycemic triad. We then also learned that it is not enough just to be effective. You also have to prevent hypoglycemia. Because hypoglycemia itself is associated with adverse cardiovascular outcomes. We then also learned that apart from controlling hyperglycemia and controlling hypoglycemia, you also have to minimize glycemic variability. So these 5 points become the glycemic pentad.
Zifam, caring for well-being.